A riveting speech was delivered by the OECS Director General, Dr. Didacus Jules, as he expanded on his independence lecture topic, Building a Nation, Shaping a Society. According to him, there is an inseparable relationship between the two. Both challenges, he highlighted, are the responsibility of all, with the political leadership setting the tone and determining the temperature of the national dialogue on this urgent matter.
We all know instinctively where we need to go and what we need to do. During the period 2001 to 2022, we have had 5 personalities as our prime ministers. And I've done a textual analysis using a word cloud of a random independent speech from each of them. The rhetoric is the same. The language urges national unity, the call to country above self, the priority on the people, the will to succeed. Looming large in the lexicon are the words you see in that map of St. Lucia. St. Lucia, country, people, national, government, economic, respect. If their words align, what is preventing the actions from aligning?
He has outlined what he says are critical initiatives which ought to be done to earnestly build a nation and shape the society. This includes institutional revitalization.
The invigoration of our national institutions with a responsive dynamism, starting with the democratization of parliament and our governance mechanisms. The restoration of service in the public service and consumer rights in the private sector. The malfunction of institutions is the major factor accounting for why nations fail. And I would urge everyone to read that book, Why Nations Fail. Reshaping our systems of governance through constitutional reform that establishes clear processes for upholding integrity and for grassroots consultation. Making Parliament a more effective instrument of governance and ensuring continuity of national development initiatives. Can approval, for example, of national development plans be done by Parliament so that we are not subject to a one step forward, two steps backward walls between administrations?
Another recommendation he made is to design policies or to strengthen mechanisms for economic inclusion.
We do live in a capitalist society, but rising inequality globally is fueling xenophobia, anger, crime. You speak to youth who are engaged in criminal activity, and you will come to appreciate that despair and hopelessness is what fuels the sense of live hard, die fast. Some examples of economic inclusion could be, for example, strengthening and empowering the credit unions so that they can broaden financial inclusion, provide avenues for participation of even the poorest in investment through mutual funds, innovate on SUSU-type revolving saving plans, and so much more. We could require foreign investors to reserve a percentage, whether it's 30, 40% of all investment value, for local participation by citizens at home and abroad through local financial intermediary institutions, like the credit unions I mentioned earlier, so that a cleaner in this office here can have shares if we invest in a regional transport system. A cleaner here can buy shares through the mutual fund in the credit union.
The education system too will need to be reviewed, says Dr. Jules, as it can no longer be just about acquiring knowledge and certification, but instead should focus on developing human and technical competences. For the DBS News World, I am Zane Romulus.